Anatomical basics of percutaneous tracheostomy. Percutaneous tracheostomy. We will first do an introduction of the method, anatomy, the procedure, to finally conclude. Introduction. We will see the definition and the history of tracheostomy. Tracheostomy is defined by the opening of the trachea. There are two main types of tracheostomy. The first type is the surgical tracheostomy. Surgical tracheostomy is the traditional method that is usually done in an operating room. It needs dissection of each cervical plan, from going to fascias, then to the muscles, then to the dissection of the isthmus of the thyroid gland, to finish with the opening of the trachea, to finally place a cannula. The other method is the percutaneous tracheostomy. Percutaneous tracheostomy is a more recent method that is usually done bedside and does not need dissection of the cervical plans. This method usually uses a fibroscope. The other particularity of this method is that it uses dilatators. Indeed, dilatators do not use the dissection of the cervical plans, and it is a less invasive method. History of percutaneous tracheostomy. Tracheostomy has been presented since antiquity. But there weren't a lot of cases. The surgical procedure was a lot used since the 1900s, and the first percutaneous tracheostomy has been done in 1953 by Sheldon. Since 1985, there have been many methods of percutaneous tracheostomy. Each method has its specific dilatation. For example, Chaila's method uses multiple dilatations. Griggs' method uses a forceps dilatation, and much more. Concerning the anatomy of the region, we will see the cutaneous landmarks, muscles, vessels, and nerves. The first landmark is the thyroid cartilage. The second one is the cricoid cartilage. The tracheostomy region is done between the first and the fourth tracheal ring. The trachea is a long tube that is flattened in the posterior part of it. It is between 12 and 15 centimeters. Here we can see the muscles surrounding the trachea. Here we see the right sternohyoid muscle. We can also see other muscles. But the muscle dissection is indeed not needed during a percutaneous tracheostomy. Percutaneous tracheostomy could lead to bleeding. This bleeding is important. Concerning the vascularization of the trachea, it is done in the arterial section by the inferior thyroid artery. Concerning the venous supplementation of the trachea, we can see that it drains the blood towards the inferior thyroid vein. If a hemorrhage occurs, we must do hemostasis to stop it. Concerning the innervation of the trachea, it is done by the vagus nerve. Around the trachea, we can find the recurrent laryngeal nerves. These nerves must be avoided during the procedure. Indeed, if these nerves are interrupted, they could lead to vocal paralysis. Concerning the section of the neck on the sixth cervical vertebra, we can see that the posterior wall of the trachea is surrounded by the esophagus. The esophagus could be touched during the procedure, meaning that fibroscopic vision is essential. Concerning the method, we will see the goals, indications, contraindications, and the method. Concerning the goal of tracheostomy is to make independent the region above the tracheostomy and the region below it. The indications. We could do tracheostomy to help weaning from mechanical ventilation. We could use it to help swallowing disorders or long-term translaryngeal intubation, which is over usually 7 days. It could be a larynx obstacle, such as a tumor, or it could be used during comatose, or sometimes during high respiratory failure. Contraindications are important. Tracheostomy shouldn't be done to patients under the age of 18. There shouldn't be any tracheostomy background or an unstable cervical spine because hyperextension is used during the procedure. There shouldn't be any high obesity or short neck. Concerning the materials used, we use a forceps, a needle and a syringe, a tracheostomy tube, dilatators, a scalpel, and a guiding wire. First, a fibroscope is introduced into the oral cavity of the patient. Here we can see the screen of the fibroscope. We can see the thyroid cartilage next to the two vocal folds. If we go deeper, we can see the larynx. And even deeper, we can see the trachea, with the zone of punction that will be made. The punction is done 2 centimeters above the sternum. This punction shows if the doctor is in the correct region. Then, an incision is made, usually 2 centimeters by length. This incision is horizontal. The second step is the insertion of a guiding wire. This guiding wire leads to the introduction of other elements, such as dilatators. Again, fibroscopic vision is essential. Then, a first dilatation is made to open for the first time the trachea. This dilatation is made with a short dilatator. Then, a second dilatation is made. This second dilatation varies between techniques. Here is represented the Griggs technique with a forceps. If bleeding occurs, we must do hemostasis. Finally, we place the tube. Concerning complications and risks, perioperative complications are asphyxia, hemorrhage, hypotension, and esophagus lesions. Long-term could be stenosis, voice paralyzed, or fistulas such as tracheomalacia. To conclude, percutaneous tracheostomy is a great alternative to surgical tracheostomy. It is more easy to use and less invasive.